Can you see what's interesting about this picture? That's right. I'm not floating off into space. And if my girlfriend decides to tip a jug of freezing cold water above me when I'm not looking, it falls down. Why? Gravity. But where the hell does gravity come from? ...1666 was the Schrodinger's cat of years, being simultaneously awful and awesome. This year in England, the Great Fire of London burned down a quarter of the people's houses, and the Great Plague swept through, killing a quarter more. At the same time, Isaac Newton came up with the theory of gravity, and the laws of motion, and optics, and some calculus too. What's interesting though, is that these events are no coincidence. You know the deal. Newton, apple, boom. But the only reason that Newton was sat under that apple tree pondering about the nature of reality was the Great Plague. You see, this is Trinity College, Cambridge, and it's where Newton worked, at least until they got scared of the plague and shut down and kicked Newton out and he went back to his childhood town. As you'd imagine, there wasn't much to do in Woolsthorpe in 1666. And so Newton just sat under a little tree and had a think. Hey presto, modern science and mathematics was born. Still, that seems like a rather steep deal. 70,000 deaths, and I'd probably haggle a bit better with the devil. He's a terrible negotiator, you can get pretty much anything for one soul. But if all it took was one summer in the countryside and the Faustian pact with the devil, then why had it taken so long? Well, the answer is above us. Oh, wait, light pollution. But if we leave London or go back in time, there's one thing we've always seen. The stars. Aristotle could see these, and his conception of the universe placed Earth firmly at the centre. These heavenly bodies moving circularly above were just doing it because it was natural. Everyone loved Aristotle and thought he was the bee's knees, especially the church, and so this theory remained dominant. But by the 17th century, people like Galileo, Kepler, and Tycho Bronze-Nose Brahe had came up with the laws of planetary motion and became the giants that Newton liked to stand on. And thus, we have Newton's universal law of gravitation. Wait, how have we got this far in the video without actually saying what gravity is? And deep breath, maths. Newton described gravity as a force, something which can move an object from a stationary position, or change its direction when moving, or stop it altogether. He observed that the gravitational force was between two masses, any two masses, and that you got a bigger force for larger masses. He also saw that the further these masses were apart, the weaker the gravitational force between them. But here's the cool thing about this equation. Whatever distance you put two objects apart, the force gets weaker and weaker, but never reaches zero. This means that right now, your body is being gravitationally attracted to the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way that sits 26,000 light years away. To complete the equation, we need to include a constant, the aptly named gravitational constant. This is a number that makes everything work exactly. Now your mass is 70 kilograms. The supermassive black hole weighs 8.2 times 10 to the 36 kilograms. The distance is 2.5 times 10 to the 20 meters, and the gravitational constant is this number. So, you and the black hole are experiencing a force of 6 times 10 to the minus 13 newtons right now toward each other. For reference, that's about the same as the weight of 60 microscopic E. coli. Newton had another equation that is true for all forces. Force equals mass times acceleration. Comparing these side by side, you can see that you accelerate toward the black hole by the gravitational constant times the mass of the black hole divided by your distance squared. You can do these calculations for any two objects in the universe, as long as you know their mass and how far apart they are from each other. In this way, we can see that the amount we accelerate towards the Earth is much larger than the amount the Earth accelerates towards us. There was a discomforting problem with Newton's idea. It just seemed absurd that two objects, no matter how far apart, could influence each other. Even Newton knew this. He said, "I believe no man who has in philosophic matters a competent faculty of thinking could ever fall into it." And so this fellow Einstein came along, and he was definitely a man of competent faculty of thinking when it came to philosophic matters. He came up with a theory that removed the strange interaction at a distance. To show this, he used a thought experiment. Say Einstein knocks you out, and you wake up in a sealed elevator that's not moving. We know from Newton's law of gravitation that you will experience an acceleration towards the Earth due to its mass. But how do you know when he knocked you out that he didn't put you in a sealed elevator, shove a couple of rockets on the bottom, and have them accelerate you into deep space at the exact same rate as Earth's gravity, creating a sort of illusion? From within the box, you'd have no idea if you were on Earth as usual, or swiftly flying to your untimely demise. Now, suddenly the gravity is turned off. You feel weightless and start floating in the middle of the elevator. Well, it's obvious you're in space, right? Einstein has turned off the rockets and you're just floating about. But how do you know you weren't in an elevator at the top of a skyscraper? And now the cable has snapped and you're in free fall towards the Earth, which makes you feel weightless and start floating in the middle of the elevator? Einstein called this his equivalence principle and used it to illustrate that if you look at things in the right way, gravity can be made to disappear. But there was one problem. Say you have a massive elevator in free fall towards the Earth from far away, and you're floating inside with Einstein. The Earth attracts in all directions towards its center, and so if you were to look across at Einstein in the elevator, he would seem to be floating closer and closer to you. As a result, you could tell that your elevator was near Earth and not floating in deep space. It seems like there's no way to use the equivalence principle to make gravity disappear in this situation, but the trick was to realize that space itself is warped. You and Einstein floating closer in the elevator is no big deal. You're simply traveling in straight lines that, because of the curvature of space around the Earth, seem to be getting closer together. How do we know that Einstein's theory is any better than Newton's theory, besides the immense air of confidence he seems to project? Because it makes better predictions that have been tested. The most famous example in Einstein's day was Mercury's orbit. Newton's prediction for this was a little off, but by treating space and time as linked and curved, Einstein got it bang on. This was the first experimental evidence that he might just be onto something. This is a collection of Einstein's equations of general relativity that he spent 8 years developing. There was a lot of maths involved, and you can tell because although this looks like one equation, it's actually 10. It sounds confusing, but basically, as theoretical physicist John Wheeler said, this equation shows how space-time tells matter to move and how matter tells space-time to curve. Gravitational lensing is another effect predicted by general relativity, but not by Newton. Take this photograph. Each blue dot is a giant quasar, a light-emitting celestial body billions of light-years away. And in the center is a galaxy millions of light-years away. The question is, how many quasars can you see? Easy, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, actually, there's only one quasar in this photo. So, in this setup, we have us on Earth, looking far off into space at a huge, massive galaxy. Then, behind this galaxy is one of our blue dots, a quasar hidden from view. We know from Einstein's theory that this big galaxy will be bending the space-time around it to quite a large degree, and we also know that the light leaving the quasar will want to travel in a straight line. So this is what it does. It goes this way, and this way, and this way, and this way, creating the four blue dots we see, when according to Newton, we should see none at all. You may have heard that gravity is the weakest force. That's because we're comparing it to the three other fundamental forces: the strong nuclear force, the weak nuclear force, and the electromagnetic force. Those three forces are all carried by tiny quantum virtual particles. In order for any two things to influence each other through a force, they have to exchange a virtual particle, a kind of touching. Naturally, people supposed, why not gravity too? And so they invented the Star Trek-y sounding graviton. Only they've never been seen. And we know they've never been seen because they are very identifiable since they spin in a particular way. So if we ever see one lurking in the bush, it's definitely a graviton and nothing else. At any rate, that's just a particle and doesn't solve our problems even if we find it. What we really need is a model of quantum gravity, and there are plenty of those going around. Maybe I'll get around to one of these in a future video. Last year, gravitational waves were seen for the first time flowing from the collision of two black holes. This was a further piece of evidence supporting general relativity, who had been telling reality for ages that there should be some little waves around here somewhere. And there are plenty more experiments underway too, but who knows? Ultimately, it's up to reality to decide. So that was where the hell gravity comes from. Let me know what you thought. Leave a comment below. I'll be hanging out there and replying to you. Thank you so much for watching. Bye.